The topic of today's drash is called Vayelech, as you can see upstairs, and I subtitle it Judgment. Vayelech, it means that to go out, you know, and Moshe went out before the people to do or to proclaim once more the Torah before them. But I subtitle it Judgment. Every year, the first 10 days of the month of Tishrei are set aside as the Asaret Yamin Teshuvah. Asaret Yamin Teshuvah. 10 days of repentance, which it means. Rabbi Abraham Halevi of the 16th century, the father of the Shelah HaKodesh, explained that this period was designated as the time for Teshuvah because Rosh Hashanah is the anniversary of man's creation. Our sages teach that God knew at the time of creation that man would not be perfect and would sin. Remember what God said in the book of Bereshit, that everything that I made is what? Is good. Oh. That is different between perfection and to be good. You understand that, right? So everything that God created is good. They are all fantastic, but they are not perfect. Only Him, blessed be He, is perfect. So He knows, God knew from the beginning that we are going to sin. God knew from the beginning that we are going to do wrong. So let's see, what did He do then? Therefore, He created the concept of Teshuvah even before He created the physical world. Before man was ever created, before the physical universe was created, God has in His plan the plan of Teshuvah. However, right, Rabbi Abraham, it would not have been seemingly for Rosh Hashanah itself to be the day of forgiveness. After all, that is the day of judgment. Therefore, Hashem has given us a period after the days of judgment to mitigate the harshness of the judgment through repentance. To do what? To mitigate the harshness of the judgment through Teshuvah. We need to understand that the Lord that we serve, the Lord our God, is the God of justice. He said, justice, justice shall you pursue. You shall pursue justice. To Him, it is very, very important. You cannot call A B or call B A. You cannot call black white or white a black. Because Anna is my friend. Because I know him. Because Anna will play golf together. Or because me and Anna will play tennis together. Or because Anna's son is my son-in-law. Then I am what? Because I am the prime minister. Then whatsoever Anna did, I close my eyes. I don't see it. It's good. It's fantastic. But if another person did the same thing, I shout, "Oh, you did wrong." But for him, I close my eyes. So where's the justice? Where is the justice? Somebody, because somebody doesn't have a good lawyer, even though his right is taken away from him because he cannot afford to pay a good lawyer to stand for him in the law court. This is the meaning of the verse of Yeshayahu chapter 55 verse 6. Yeshayahu Isaiah chapter 55 verse 6. He said, "Seek Adonai when he can be found," which as sages say it a reference to the Asaret Yamin Teshuvah. Well, that means it's a reference to the 10 days of repentance. When can he be found? Who is he? The Holy One, blessed be He. When can He be found? Only after He showed Himself by creating the world. The Holy One, blessed be He, was only found or can only be found after creating the world. Therefore, continue Rabbi Abraham, on each day of the 10 days of repentance, one can turn aside somewhat from his mundane affair, or even better, at night, when he is in any case free from the inherent interference of other people, to reflect on its sins and confess them. When can you do this? Of course, he said it is mostly important when we refrain ourselves from our mundane affairs, from our daily activities, especially at night, when we are calm, when the time is calm. You are in your private house, in your private home, in your private setting, you go down and you reflect, right? Reflect of your deeds. What have I done throughout last year? How did I offend my wife? How did I offend my husband? How did I offend my children, my neighbor, my co-workers, some members of the synagogue? What have I done wrong? In my business dealing, have I cheated? Have I covered what is not mine? Have I taken another person's property wrongfully? Or because I have the power, I can dominate them and do whatever I want. I don't care. We reflect on our activities, on our actions. What do we do wrong and how can we make it right? This should be done with crying, tears, and heartbreak, as if a close relative had died. As we read in Tehillim chapter 119, verse 136, my eyes shed stream of tears because they did not keep your Torah. A repentant person should not underestimate the importance of tears. For our sages have taught that the gates of tears are never locked. I repeat, our sages have taught that the gates of tears are never locked. That is in Emek Beraha. I'm saying here that we, as a child of God, we, as a new being, must go in our private home, in our private setting, and cry aloud before the Lord. I'm not saying crocodile tears. We have crocodile tears. Though they come, they cry, oh! And they, immediately after 2 seconds, they go back to that way of life, their old way of life. They go back to their sin. That's the crocodile tears. But I mean real tears that comes out from the bottom of your heart, from your soul, regretting your action, regretting your wrongdoing and making it right. Not just the crocodile tears that you cry, ah, yeah, 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 and you go back again to your sin. No. I'm talking the sincere one, the rightful one, the good one that you actually comes out of your soul, out of your mind, and you're asking God for repentance. You're asking Him, forgive me for my wrongdoing. But I said, before that, you have to make it right. You go to the person that you know that you have wronged, ask for forgiveness. Those are the stages of teshuvah. You have to be convinced first out of your soul that you did something wrong. If you are not convinced, of course, how can you go and seek forgiveness? As some of our politicians are saying, it was so sad. I was reading the news. Some of our politicians are saying that this is Canada. You can do whatever you want. What type of a statement is that? You can do whatsoever you want. So someone can be a terrorist, it's good. Someone can blow up somebody, it's good. You cannot do whatever you want. There is law that you have to follow. Those laws are put there not just for putting them sake. We have constitution that everybody has to follow. It doesn't matter big or small. It doesn't matter rich or poor. You have to follow the rules and the regulations. You can't do whatever you want. The same thing in the Torah. You cannot do whatever you want. That is what Hollywood is telling us. That is what the mentality of the Western world now. This is a free world. You can do whatsoever you want. No, you cannot do whatsoever you want. There is a limit to your freedom. Where my freedom ends is where another person's freedom starts. I cannot just overrule everybody and say, this is my freedom, I can do whatever I want to do. No. In Canada, you can achieve whatsoever, anything, because it's a free society. You can attain to any degree, but you cannot do whatsoever you want, because there is rules and regulation, there is law. And Moshe went and he spoke the following word to all Israel, Devarim, Deuteronomy chapter 31, verse 1. When a person goes to the court in the world of people, it is usually perfectly clear why to all parties involved. They know the basis of the court case and what it means to win or to lose. Rosh Hashanah is somewhat different. We know in general what it is all about. And every year, people get up to define the day of Rosh Hashanah and the judgment that is handed down to give people a better idea about how to use this opportunity. You could think that after thousands of years, we exactly know what to focus on, besides just wanting to be a better child of God. Over thousands of years, we all know what Rosh Hashanah is. We all know the day of judgment. We all prepare for it. Some of us will fast to ask God for forgiveness. Some of us will become sober from all our wrongful doing. Some of us will do some other things to draw us close to our God. It's not as if we perfected all these things. We know it all, step by step. You know, it's like we've been taught since we're young. It's like a formula. Okay, this is formula one, formula two, step three, step four, step five. This is how we go. But interestingly enough, in spite of all the drasha I have had on the topic, and all the different thoughts that they have offered, I am surprised that none ever refer to this. What is this? Rabbi said, when man is led in for judgment, he is asked, did you deal faithfully? That is, with integrity. Did you fix time for learning? Did you engage in procreation? Did you anticipate redemption? Did you engage in the dialectic of wisdom? Did you understand one thing from another? Even so, if the fear of God is his treasure, then it is good. If not, then not. That is Shabbat chapter 31, 31a. What am I trying to say here? That is written in Shabbat in Shabbat 31a. He said, when a man is led in a judgment, he is asked the following question: did you deal faithfully? Did you deal with integrity? Actually, this is basically in the world to come, when you are led after this earthly life, when we go to the higher realm, when you led before the Almighty, the following questions are asked: did you deal faithfully? Did you fix time to learn? Learning what? The Torah. Did you engage in procreation? Because it's a commandment, it's a mitzvah for reprocreate. That you shall reprocreate and what? And multiply. There is nowhere in the Torah that said you have to do family planning. Yes, it is very important for you to plan ahead of time, right? Okay, this is the amount of children I want to have. This is what I want to do. This is I need to work, you know, save money and so on and so forth. But most of our own plan does not convert to the plan of God, right? Some of us will have, you know what, I want to have just only one child. And at the end, God is telling you have to have as many as you want. We will say, I want to have just only two. At the end, you just have one. So God has a plan for each and every one of us. We should not use our own limited human understanding to block the plan of God. Oh, you know what? I don't have the money. I have complained like that too. I have the same idea. You know, I want to finish my degree. You know, I want to do this, I want to do that. You know, oh, I don't have the money for a house. I cannot have children now. La, 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 la. All kinds of excuses. Then, my rabbi said, Yitzhak, is enough of complaining. Go and get married. I said, Rabbi, it's a big responsibility. I have to, no money to take care of the woman, la 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 la. He said, enough is enough. Go get married. I'm telling you, I went and get married. I have planned everything in my own mind, but God turned it upside down. Said, that's your plan. It's not my plan. It doesn't work. I work hard. The more I work hard, before I got married, right? Not, I don't even know the money. It just disappeared. I don't know how they disappear. It just disappeared. I work, the more I work hard, the more the money disappeared. What is going on? I'm single. I mean, this is the salary. This salary is good. I should save and do all kinds of things. I never save. I got married, the same salary, understand my people, the same salary, God gave me a house. Is that possible? God gave me children, and I didn't have another job. It's not that I have some millions of dollars more, not the same salary. How can the same salary take care of a woman, three children, and me? And when I was single, the same salary cannot take care of me alone. Where is the sense? Where is the logical sense? There's no logical sense. But God is saying, go to procreate. I will bless you. That $1 that you have, that you think it's not enough, God will multiply them. But when you are single, you don't want to obey, that $1 that you have, or that $200 that you have, God will give you a lot of expenses to spend it on. So he's going. He will never come back. But when you obey him, he will multiply you. True, this section of the Talmud is talking about a person's final day of judgment after they have left this world for the next one, as I said. But why should every Rosh Hashanah not be a discussion about the same issue, especially since, as Zilhem explained, heaven evaluates whether or not a person is already Ben Olam Haba, that is, destined for the world to come. Second question is, if fear of God is the most important thing, why not just say this? Why go through the list of six activities first, only to emphasize the importance of the fear of heaven at the end? And what with this list? Why have these six things been singled out for the heavenly evaluation? A similar question can be asked in Parashat Akev. After Moshe Rabbeinu basically finished teaching all the Torah, all the 613 mitzvot, he came back and said, after all, what does Adonai your God want? That you should fear the Lord your God. That you should fear the Lord your God. After all these things, the basic thing is the fear of heaven. As it is said that God can do all things. The heaven can do all things. But what the heaven cannot do is to force you to fear him. No. God will never force you to fear him. Heaven can do all. God can perform any miracles. He can do everything that he wants. But the Holy One, blessed be he, will never force you to serve him. Never. It's your choice. You decide. It's my choice to serve him or not. You are not a zombie, remember. You are not a robot. You choose. But he said, I presented before you this day life and death. But I advise you as my children to choose life. For life is good. So it is your choice. Heaven can do anything except the fear of heaven. The heaven will never force you. God will never force you. The Holy One, blessed be he, will never force me or you to serve him. We decide. So, not so fast. Do we still have to do all the 613 mitzvot? So, what did Moshe Rabbeinu mean when he said only to fear God, your Elohim? And certainly, that, as Talmud points out as well, it is no small feat to achieve and to keep. The answer to all the questions is the difference between goals and means. Fear of God is the goal, and the rest of the mitzvot is the means. The fear of God is the goal here. But all the mitzvot are the means to get to the goal. If combining all the mitzvot, the 613 mitzvot, the 10 words, everything combined, the summary of all of this is to love the Lord your God, as Yeshua HaMashiach said, to love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and to love your neighbor as yourself. That is it. To love the Lord your God. Well, what does that mean? To fear Him. The fear that we're talking about here is not this kind of fear. Oh, no. But loyalty. To be loyal to the Lord your God. To be loyal to His word. To give Him all your being. To give Him everything that you own. And let Him control. You lose everything. Don't say, oh, I'm going to close everything. I want to be in control. No. Leave the control to the Almighty. I just gave my own testimony now. I just gave my own experience now. I was trying to control everything by myself, but it doesn't work. I try all the knowledge I have acquired in the university to try to manage my work, my finance, my economy, but it didn't work. What I did wrong, I don't know. I try to search, reflect back, but I see that yes, when you are single, you have no responsibility. You can fly, you know, you're like a bird. You can fly and go to all kinds of parties, you know. The $2, the $5, the $3 that you are spending in those parties with your friends and so on, it's money. It's going. You don't know they are going. But when you have responsibility, you know that the children are there, the wife is there, you have to defend them, you have to provide for them, you have to put shelter on their head. Your mentality changes. Your ideas of life is changed because of the responsibility that you have. And that is what God is saying here. Give me the control. I will control it for you and everything will be good. And this particular list of mitzvot is mentioned because they are kind of a group leaders. Each one is a mitzvah that comes to fight back a certain human tendency to play God. For example, why does a person cheat in business? If not because they feel God does not have their back and isn't giving them all they need through legal means. Why must you cheat in your business? Why must you deceive in your business? Oh, you know what? I am a smart man. I work in Wall Street. I can manipulate the figures. I can manipulate my finance. I can take people's money. You know, people trust you. You're an insurance company. You're a bank. People trust you with their life, with their finance, with their tears, you know, with their sweat. Because their labor is a sweat. They trust you with all this. They put it in for you to control, and you do what you invest with them all. Because you think you are very smart. Why do you do that? Because you have no fear of heaven. Because you don't consider others as human. You are the only human, the rest are animals. That's why you can do what? You can embezzle their money and do what? I'm trying to remember this word. You can fraud them. Thank you. You fraud them for no reason. Because you think you are smarter than them. What about fixing time for learning? Well, if you really like spending time with someone, you don't leave it to a chance. You don't leave each one this time without suggesting a next time. Some people even set up a time to meet each week on a regular basis, just to make sure they don't miss one another. Remembering what is read in the book of Bereshit, Adam, Adam, Adam. Every day the Lord God will come and Adam will rejoice before God, right? Oh, Papa, you are here again. Oh, this is what I did, this is what I did. They have a time. Do you set time apart to meet with your Creator? Do you set time apart to meet with Him who make you? Do you have a private time where you communicate with Him? Because remember, He always rejoices to see you. He always rejoices to meet with you. He always rejoices to discuss with you. He always rejoices to have a conversation, a personal relationship with you. And when you neglect that, you say, you know what, I don't care. God does not listen. God has 200 billion, 200 trillion accountable business. He doesn't care about me. No, he cares about you. You have to set apart the time. Because remember, we are still in the day of judgment. Yom Kippurim is coming. When the day of atonement, we have these 10 days for us to make it right. To make what we did wrong, to make them right. And to ask God for pure, complete forgiveness of our iniquity. We learn Torah to meet with God. It is our common ground. If a person approaches Torah on a casual basis, they act as if they don't really care much about meeting with God, as if they don't need Him. Not enough fear of God there. If you don't study your Torah, if you don't go deep to seek the Word of God, the enemy come. Remember that the enemy understands the Word of God too, because this is the constitution of the heaven. Torah is the constitution of heaven. So the enemy understands that word perfectly well. And that is the same thing he did when he was talking to Yeshua. He said, oh, did the Torah say this? You can jump. And the Torah said, I will lift, I will take you up. You will not dash your leg against a stone. I will protect you. That is true, the Torah says so. But how do you act upon it? The Torah didn't ask us to be stupid or to be foolish. That is, he's asking him to test God. You don't test God. You don't test the Lord, your God. And Yeshua replied, thou shalt not test the Lord, thy God. So, understanding that the enemy understands the Torah perfectly well. He is not stupid. He's smart and he's very, very wise. So therefore, we also, if we did not indulge ourselves in the Torah, how can we reply him? When it comes with temptation against us, how do we reply? Because you are empty inside, there is no Torah, you don't know the word to defend yourself with. But when you engage in the study of the Torah, when the enemy comes with one word, you know how to counteract those words because you understand the Torah perfectly well. Procreation is a godly act, for sure. But playing God when it comes to bad is a common thing, as genetic engineering show. There is one particular account in the Talmud that is exactly about this. The story of Hezekiah HaMelech. Reprocreation is good. Reprocreation is a godly act. It is a mitzvah. It's a commandment of the Almighty. But how do we do this? Are we the one to decide when? Or do we leave it to the Almighty to decide? What did the Holy One, blessed be He, do or did? He brought suffering to Hezekiah. And then told Yeshayahu, go and visit the sick. As it says, in those days Hezekiah became healed to the point of death. And Yeshayahu, son of Amos, the prophet, came and said to him, so said the Lord Elohim, the God of hosts, command your house, for you shall surely die, but not live. Remember, that is Yeshayahu chapter 38, verse 1. Isaiah chapter 38, verse 1. I repeat again. So said God, Lord of hosts, command your house, for you shall die and not live. What type of a question is this? What type of things, what type of vision, what type of things is this? The Lord, I have to serve you with all my heart. I have did everything that you asked me to do. I have obeyed the commandment. I have done this and this and this and this. It's like the prophet was what? Was proclaiming. But he's been punished because of one thing. Let's see. Why do I deserve such a severe punishment? Asked the king. Why did the Lord my God punish me with death? What did I do wrong? Why sickness? I have obeyed him. I have done everything that he has commanded me. Why this? Here is the answer. Because answered Ishayahu, you did not have children, because the king did not have children. Let's see. But I saw through prophecy that I will have evil children. What business has you with the mystery of God? Rahot chapter 10, 8. Because the prophet told me that my children will be evil. So therefore, in order for me not to have evil children, I would not want to have children. Who are you to decide? Are you playing God now? As we see in today's 21st century. I want to have boys, not girls. Or I want to have girls, not boys. I will go and give my sperm to the sperm bank and do what? Let them decide for me which one is XY and which one is XX. Who are you to play God? Who are you to start manipulating genes? As I read also two days ago, there is a new project in the United States. They want to make what is called a super soldier by manipulating genes. They say we want to make a human being that is resistant to biological and chemical weapons. What type of life is that? What are you trying to do? Why do you want to manipulate human genes? What do you want to create a being that is not fully human? Why are you playing God? Why do we want to play God? The king said the same thing. Remember, the Torah said there is nothing new under the sun. This is 3,000-4,000 years ago. Hezekiah, the king, said, I don't want to have children because I saw through a prophecy. I was told that my children will be evil. So therefore, because I want to be good, I don't want to have evil children, I don't want to have children at all. But who are you to decide? God said, procreate, that is a commandment. You try your best to train your children in the path of the Torah, in the way of the Torah, then it is left for them to decide, not you. You do all your possible best as parents to guide them in the way of the Torah. You do all your possible best to put their feet in the Torah, but let them decide to follow or not. It is not your business to say, because I saw through prophecy, because this man told me, or before that man told me this, I'm not going to have children. It's not your business. Do the commandment and see what follows. Bad may be common, but it is also a great mystery. It is also hard to balance between what we as parents want for our children and what God Himself wants. And since God does not share His plan with us, we tend to only see things through our own eyes, creating all kinds of tension and clashes, many of which are quite destructive to both child and parent. Anticipating redemption is easy when one's life is being threatened on a regular basis. Anticipating it when life is good shows that a person realizes that as good as Ezra is for the Jews themselves, it is never good for the Shekinah. As we as Jews see that in exile, because remember, we are sitting in exile in the Western world. We are not yet all in Israel. Right? As good as we think we are in exile. Oh! Remember, in the 30s, the same thing the German Jews did. Ah! Germany is good. Germany are civilized people. The German are not barbaric. The German cannot kill. They are well advanced in technology. Germans are well, you know, I mean, it will never happen in their mind. The rabbi says, it's time to go home. They say, no, we're not going home. Germany is good. Our business are prospering. Right? Everything that we see it from the spectacle or from the prison of financial prosperity. From financial blessing. Our eyes have been blind to the spiritual prosperity, which is number one, which is the basic. Once we are good, once we rejoice, once we are blessed, oh, that is good, that is nice, fantastic. I don't care about the land of Israel. Germany is very good. They're civilized people. They cannot be barbaric. But what happened? We saw it. they were slaughtered like chicken. So where is the civilization? Where are the knowledge and the advancements? The same thing that they were doing now again. The same we are repeating. But in the Western world, yeah, America is good. America has civilized people. They are well advanced. They can never turn against us. The government of the United States is in our hand. We control them. You know, our lobbies are nice guys. You know, we can lobby anything. And everything will be right. But are we repeating the mistake of old? Are we again repeating that particular mistake that we did? Where is our spirituality? Remember that, yes, exile is good for us financially, business wise, materially, it's good, but it's not good for the Shekinah, it's not good for the presence of God, because the presence of God was raised in Jerusalem, in the temple, when it's rebuilt. It's not good for the Shekinah, because the Shekinah will not rest in exile, but in the temple. It is never good for the Shekinah while the nation is scattered. The temple is unbuilt. The Torah is not official government policy. Then the anticipation of redemption is clearly for the as the Vilna explained, for the sanctification of God's name and not just for the personal relief. Did you engage in the dialectic of wisdom? And did you understand one thing from another? Important for many things, but it is most important for being able to look at creation and see God everywhere. As one pursue increasingly deeper level of the Torah, they are really pursuing God Himself. Climbing the wisdom ladder takes a person from one level to a higher level, one top of which is infinite light of God. As we perform wisdom, as we can differentiate one thing from another, as we study more of the Torah, as we increase in the ladder of the Torah, from step one to step two, from step three to step four, as we go, knowing that at the top of it is the infinite light of the Almighty. It makes us different from other people. Not just, you know, keeping the mitzvah for keeping sake. Is it actually out of your heart? Are you keeping it because you do it because you fear heaven? Are you keeping it because you fear the Almighty? Because you are loyal to Him? Because you love Him? Because you want to do as your Father has commanded you? Or are you just doing it just for formality? Just to see that, oh, you know what? I'm a rabbi. Or you know what? I'm a child of God. You know what? I want to be like a uniform. You decide. Well, I have decided to follow Him. What do you decide? What have you decided? Let's follow our Creator, our King. Then all things shall be made perfect for us. In the Haftarah of this morning, this Shabbat is not as Shabbat Shuvah. But this Shabbat is not as Shabbat Shuvah. Because of the Haftarah that begins with the word Shuvah Israel. Return, Israel, gleaned from both, which is gleaned from both Hosea and Joel. The prophet described Hashem's desire to forgive his children if only they will repent, if only they will make Teshuvah. And the fast of Yom Kippur is mentioned as well as the reward awaits us if we proclaim God in our midst. The Zohar says that there really is only one giant mitzvah, and that is to choose life. All the rest of the mitzvah are advice on how to achieve choosing life. Life is ultimately cleaving to Hashem, who is eternal. Death is capitulating to the temptation of the temporal. I repeat again, Zohar says that there really is only one giant mitzvah, and that is to choose life. Because it is a commandment for us to choose life. God said, I advise you to choose life. All the rest of the mitzvah are advice on how to achieve choosing life. Life is ultimately cleaving to the Holy One, blessed be He. Life is ultimately cleaving to the Almighty, to your Creator, to your God. Cleave to Him. Hold Him very, very tight. But if you did not hold Him tight, death is capitulating in the temptation of the temporal. Remember, lust is temporal. This flesh is temporal. It's not eternal. And if you yield to the advice of the flesh, where will your soul be? Where will your soul be at the day of judgment, at the last day? If you devote yourself of wisdom to follow the Holy One with all your heart, with all your mind, with all your being, will you clear yourself to the physical and say, you know what? The most important to me is financial prosperity. The most important to me is materialistic wisdom or materialistic wealth. But at the end, you will not take a cent, you will not take a dime to the water camp. Everything ends here. So, where is your soul? As it is said in Romans chapter 10 that we just read, he says, and I read, as it is written, how beautiful is the feet of the herald of peace and the herald of good things. But all of them have not obeyed the proclamation of the good news. For Yeshayahu said, my master, who has believed our report? Therefore, faith is from the hearing in the ear, and the hearing in the ear is from the word of Elohim. I repeat. Therefore, faith is from the hearing in the ear, and the hearing in the ear is from the word of Elohim. In other version, it said, faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. How do we acquire this faith? When you listen, it doesn't go here and comes out here. When it goes here, it's settled here. It's germinated. It has roots, and it grows. Not only growing, remember, it bears fruit. What is your fruit? What is my fruit? What is the fruit that we can tangibly say, this is the fruit of our good work? Remember, the Torah is work. You have to work, and it's by faith. You have to believe. It is not a religion. It is a faith of our forefathers. Abraham believed, and it was counted to him as righteousness. He believed in his Creator, and was counted to him as righteousness. So it is not a religion, my friend. Judaism is not a religion, but a faith. That when you believe, it will be counted to you as righteousness. It is not about being smart. That is just a side benefit. It's not about getting honor from people less bright. And it is not about getting ahead materially in life because of personal genius. It is about being spiritually sanctified so that a person does not lose track of God in their life. This is true fear of God. And that is what we evaluate for each Yom Kippur. As the Yom Kippur draws near, let's reevaluate our lives. As Yom Kippur, the Day of Atonement, draws near, how can you evaluate yourself from last year to this year, this new year? What have you gained spiritually? What have you lost spiritually? What level are you now? And what is your plan for this year? Do you want to remain on this level, or do you want to go to the higher level? Or do you want to decrease from this level? You have to decide. We have to decide, my friends. We have to know what is our commitment to the Torah. What is your commitment to the word of God? What is your commitment to life? For it's a mitzvah to choose life. Choosing life is very important to the Holy One, because the Holy One is life. I want us to choose life to clean ourselves, to hold Him so tight. For He said it is a tree of life to those who take hold of it. Torah is a tree of life to those who take hold of it. And His ways are ways of pleasantness. All His paths are peace. Bring us back, Lord, to You, and we shall come. Renew our days as of old. Let us all come unto Him. Let us all return unto Him. He said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Holy One but by Me. No one comes to the Holy One only through the Torah. Torah is the ticket to the world to come. Nobody goes to Him, to the Holy One, except the Torah. The Torah is the constitution of the heavens, and we have to follow Him. Yeshua HaMashiach has given us what? A path. It is not a rocket science. It's not hard. He has shown us the path. Our job is just to walk, follow. That is it. It's not hard. The path has been cleared. Remember, He said, I will send My angel before you, and My angel will prepare all your way. Yeshua has gone before us to prepare all the way. Why are we making it difficult? Why do we add and add and add what does not matter? Why do we want to make it heavy when it is simple? The way is there. Just follow, and everything will be okay. Shabbat shalom.
Shabbat shalom. Thank you.
Good tango.
Yeah, shalom.